Just that galaxy that we live on. And I was reading about it this week, and it was explained that the shape of this galaxy we live in is it's like a pancake. It's like this big pancake with a bulge in the middle. And yesterday when I was making breakfast, I made a little replica of it. This is not to scale. Okay, but it's this whole idea of, okay, if this were our galaxy, that's pretty good, huh? Put a little golf ball in there and flipped it. Okay, if this were our galaxy, this is so fascinating. Okay, there's not even a chance that I could make a speck visible to the human eye to show us our whole solar system. Okay, there's no way that you would see our whole solar system, our sun, everything within this galaxy. Because you know how big this is? A light year, okay, a light year is traveling at the speed of light. The speed of light is 186,000 miles a second. Think about that. 186, if you could go 186,000 miles in 1 second, that's fast. 186,000 miles in a second. That's a light year. No, that's a speed of light. A light year is traveling at 186,000 miles a second for a whole year. Imagine how far you would go in 1 second, much less 1 year. That's a light year. Do you know how long it would take to get from one edge of our galaxy to the other? 100,000 miles. Light years. So to get from this edge to this edge, you would have to travel at 186,000 miles per second for 100,000 years. You just go, what? That doesn't make any sense. That's how long it would take to get from one edge to a galaxy to the other. So imagine how fast you would pass the Earth within the first fraction of a second. As the Earth is just a few thousand miles in diameter. I mean, you can't even measure that within a second. And you're going to travel for 100,000 years at the speed of light to get from one edge to the other. There's no way you would see our Earth, that our Earth is buried in this somehow. And the last scene where I showed you were all those galaxies. Do you know how many of these things are out there? They're estimating about 350 billion. 350 billion galaxies, and we're buried as this tiny planet inside of one of these. And God says, I've set my glory above the heavens. Are you fascinated by what I made? You should see me. The God who created all of this. See, and it blows me away how people will walk in here and think they're big. Are you kidding me?
Someone recently from another church mentioned to me that their church was getting so big. It was a church that was growing, and they didn't like it. They said, I like a small church. And my immediate response out loud was that Jesus doesn't. Jesus doesn't like them small. Jesus said, on this rock I'll build my church. I don't think Jesus had in mind building a tiny church. In Matthew 16, 17 through 18, when Jesus said to his disciples, who do people say that I am? He said, a prophet, Jeremiah, different things. Who do you say that I am? And eventually Peter said, you are the Christ, the Messiah. You are the Son of the living God. And Jesus replied, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. In other words, you didn't just conjure this up in your mind, but God gave you that information by his Holy Spirit. And you've just spoken it out. And I tell you that on that kind of a faith, Peter, on a faith that understands that I am the Messiah, that I am the only way to heaven, that I am the way, the truth, and the life, on the building blocks of that, I'm going to build my church. And it will be so strong that even the gates of hell can't chip away at it. 2 Peter 3:9, that we heard just a few moments ago, the Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. He is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. So those of you who sit here who don't happen to have a personal relationship with Jesus, the reason Jesus hasn't already returned is because of you. Because he's not slow in keeping his promise. You see, the disciples thought Jesus was going to come back from heaven in their lifetime. And all of a sudden, they were starting to die off, and they go, oh, when Jesus said he's coming back soon, maybe that wasn't according to our time frame. Maybe that's that whole day is to the Lord like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like a day thing. So we better start writing some things down. That's why the Gospels weren't written for quite a while, because there was no need. They just told people the stories, and they expected that Jesus was coming then. But Jesus saw you and me 2,000 years later, and he wanted us to come to repentance, to turn toward him and give him our lives and trust him so that we too could have eternal life. Let's pray. Lord, we are so small, as Francis Chan just pointed out to us, and you are so big. We don't know if all of his facts, considerations of how many billions of galaxies or whatever are correct. There's no way we can know that. What we do know is that you're big, and that you want a big, big house. You even said you're going to prepare lots of rooms for us. Help us to get that today. In Jesus' name. Amen. The title of the message is Jesus is not constructing a tiny house. I don't know if any of you have ever seen the shows about tiny houses that are out there where people are getting things that are basically glorified be moved around quite easily, and where oftentimes people have to pay property taxes because they're just staying on a place where they can pay cheap fees for the land they're on, or just keep moving around or whatever. It's a fascinating thing to watch. I don't think I could do it very well. I want to spread out a little bit, but a number of people are doing that around the country today, but not Jesus. Luke chapter 14, verses 16 and 23. So this is the beginning and the end of a text that goes together. Jesus said, "A certain man was preparing a great banquet, invited many guests. The master told his servant, 'Go out to the roads and the country lanes and make them come in so that my house will be full.'" And that's what we're looking at today primarily, is where Jesus says, I want my house to be full. And so let's kind of dive deep into this text a little bit. The text is really all of Luke 14, but the later part mostly, especially when we get to that verse 23. But let's look at the setup. Let's look at how Luke sets up the parable that Jesus is going to use to teach us about how he views church and eternity in heaven. Okay? So we're going to back up to Luke chapter 14, verse 1. The Pharisees were out to get Jesus. Okay, these are the religious leaders. They don't like the things that Jesus is doing. They don't like the things that Jesus is saying. And they are out to get him. And one Sabbath, their day of worship, Jesus was eating at the house of a prominent Pharisee, of a high-ruling religious official. And he was being carefully watched. So Jesus wasn't invited over because they wanted to be buddy-buddy with him. Jesus was invited over because they wanted to find something wrong with him. And so they are carefully watching Jesus at this meal. There in front of Jesus was a man suffering from dropsy. Today we might look at that as Bell palsy, where things just aren't working completely in the body. Jesus asked the Pharisees and the experts in the law, "Is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath, on the worship day, or not?" Because you see, you weren't allowed to do any work, and healing somebody could be considered work. There were laws about these things. But the Pharisees and the experts in the law remained silent. They're keeping a careful watch on him. They're not saying anything. They're not giving anything away. You can imagine the meeting before this, when they all got together and said, "Don't say anything to him. Just be quiet. He's going to trip over himself. He's going to do something. Let's just sit and watch." And so they don't say anything. So take a hold of the man. He healed him. He made it completely well, and he sent him away. Then he asked them, again, Jesus asked the Pharisees, "If any one of you has a son or an ox," you determine which is better, your family or your livelihood, I guess. "If any one of you has a son or ox that falls into a well on a Sabbath day, on the day of worship, will you not immediately pull him out?" Well, of course they would, wouldn't they? But they had nothing to say. They continued to remain silent. So let's transition now to the second part of the setup for the parable that Jesus is going to tell us. Verse 7 of Luke 14. When he noticed how the guests had picked the places of honor at the table, it says he told them this parable. Now, I really don't think this is a parable yet, except for the first line. I think this is Jesus just telling them like it is. He looks at them, he sees that when they came in, they're all shuffling for the place of honor at the table, because if you're up near the host, that's the place of honor. And the further you are away, that's the lesser place of honor. But all of them were trying to get up toward the head of the table, and Jesus saw this taking place. And here's what makes it kind of a parable. He says, when someone invites you to a wedding feast. So he wasn't too direct with them, but then he says it like it is. When someone invites you to a wedding feast, do not take the place of honor. For a person more distinguished than you may have been invited. If so, the host who invited both of you will come to you and say, "Give this man your seat." Then, humiliated, you'll have to take the least important seat. But when you're invited, take the lowest place, So that when your host comes, he'll say to you, friend, move up to a better place. Then you'll be honored in the presence of all your fellow guests. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and everyone who humbles himself will be exalted. So that's the setup. Now the actual text, the actual parable that Jesus is teaching us, starting in verse 15, and we're going to go all the way to 24, but remember verse 23 is kind of our key verse today. The next person speaking, which is one of the people at the meal, one of the Pharisees or experts in the law, they obviously didn't hear or get anything that Jesus was just saying. When one of those who was at the table heard this, he said to Jesus, blessed is the man who will feast in the kingdom of God. He basically is saying to Jesus, Jesus, I'm going to be feasting in the kingdom of God. What about you? Jesus replied, now we get the parable. A certain man was preparing a great banquet and invited many guests, not just three, but many guests. At the time of the banquet, he sent his servant to tell those who had been invited, come, for everything is now ready. Now today, if you're invited to something, many of you will get an e-vite. That means through Facebook or some other means, you're going to get it electronically. In fact, you can respond, you can RSVP just by clicking on a thing to say you'll be there, and then your calendar will give you a reminder. Or you might get something in the mail that will tell you what the date and time when the event's taking place, and you will know that that's when you're supposed to go. Apparently, at this time, things were a little more general. So an invitation was sent out saying there's going to be a wedding banquet and that you are invited, but you don't know the exact date or the hour when it's going to be. But it's going to be so amazing and so great, there's no way, there's nothing that can come in your way from missing this wedding banquet. And so the master sends out the servant to tell everybody who had been invited, come. For everything is now ready. Of course, everybody's going to come. But they all, again, not just three, because we're going to hear about three of them, they all began to make excuses. The first one said, I've just bought a field. I must go see it. Please excuse me. Another one said, I just bought 5 yoke of oxen and I want to try them out. Please excuse me. Still another said, I just got married, so I can't come. The excuses were, I have possession, I have work, and I have relationships that stand between me and responding to the invitation. What keeps people from putting their faith in Jesus or from having acceptance of an invitation from you to even come to church? Well, possessions, you got too many toys and want to go play on Sunday morning. Work, many people do have to work or choose to work on a Sunday morning. Relationships. Well, my spouse, my friend, my whoever isn't a Christian and doesn't like church, and so I think it's more important for me just to stay with them. That's just three. There's a whole lot of other excuses there could be. In fact, it said all of them made excuses, but there's three for us. The servant came back. He reported this to his master. Then the owner became angry. Can you imagine? You have spent thousands and thousands and thousands and tens of thousands of dollars on this fantastic wedding banquet, and somebody in your family is getting married, and you invite them, and nobody comes. Not a single person who was invited. I think you would be justified in being a little angry. God is offering eternal life. He sent his son to die so that we could receive forgiveness. I think God would be justified in being mad if Jesus went to the cross and nobody who had been invited to receive life responded. Because eternal life comes at a high cost for Jesus, for his Father in heaven. So the servant came back, reported to his master. The master became angry and ordered his servant to go out quickly into the streets and the alleys of the town, bring in the poor, the crippled, the blind, and the lame. In other words, in those days, there were very definite socio category of people were in a lower strata of life at that point. So apparently people up here were invited and they didn't respond. So they said, go invite the people we wouldn't normally invite. What a good servant the master had. Sir, the servant said, what you have ordered had already been done. Right? The servant took initiation. He already knew what the master wanted, and so he just did it. He said, but still there's room. Then the master told the servant, then go out to the roads and to the country lanes and make them come in so that my house will be full. I tell you, not one of those men who were invited will get a taste of my banquet. All of those first-tier people who had been invited, who had made excuses, not one of them will taste the banquet. Translate that into eternal life. That God has sent out an invitation. And whatever that, when that first invitation went out, then all those people who don't respond, who make excuses, will not get to taste eternal life. But because a lot of people came in that second invitation, but still there's lots of room at the table. There's still lots of room in the house. And the master says, go out to every home. Go out into that country lane that is dirt, that's bumpy, that nobody would ever think of going to give an invitation to them, and find them and invite them as well. Find everybody that hasn't been invited yet and invite them. Why? So my house may be what? Full. So my house may be full. I don't think Jesus had in mind a tiny house, a tiny church. He wants his church to be full. He doesn't want any to perish, but all to come to repentance. He wants us to go and invite everyone to eternal life. That's what this is really about. But how does that happen? So much so, not always, but primarily through the church. So if the church isn't full, it's likely that God's house, his eternal house, isn't going to be full. I thought about an argument against this as I was preparing to preach myself. I thought somebody could say, yeah, but there's lots of churches, so every church doesn't have to be big. Right? That's a good argument. Why not have millions of little tiny churches? I think that makes sense. In fact, that was the emphasis of the small group movement that started about 20-some years ago. Dale Galloway was kind of a guru of this. And one of the things that Dale Galloway said, primary purpose of a small group is to reproduce itself. In other words, you get together, you form a small group of anywhere from 6 to 12 people, and you have somebody who's the leader, and you have an apprentice. You have somebody who is being taught how to be a leader. And at some point, once you get a few more people coming, and you're really no longer teeny tiny small, you multiply and you reproduce another small group that will reproduce small groups, and you keep reproducing more. Here's the fallacy of that and what really happened with small groups. Small groups get together and they like each other. They spend time together and they feel comfortable together, and they've shared secrets that they don't want somebody else to know, but they feel comfortable with confidence in this group. And so groups became ingrown, and groups weren't multiplying themselves. And I've seen this in churches over and over again. They try to do small groups, and they're great, but some of them go on for years. In fact, I think I can share this. My last church, we tried re-upping sort of small groups, and there were a couple of groups who said, no, we're closed. We don't want anybody else. We're not designed to multiply. We like our groups so much. Now, there's something good about that too, right? To have that kind of group. But when you look at it in the economy of God, there's something really wrong with that. And so that whole tiny church thing at least hasn't worked to keep multiplying itself. And so if not that, then the churches around the world need to be growing. And we all know that in the United States, at least, over the last 20 years, churches have been doing what? Declining. This church used to have 500 people on Sunday morning. Yes? Right? And or more. Right? This church has seen it. But don't feel so bad, because that's not unusual. That's very much par for the course. But I believe Jesus wants to change that. I believe he wants his house to be full, as the scriptures say. Well, let me kind of bring this together with this. My dad died on his 77th birthday a number of years ago, and he passed on to me his love for games, his love for play. I passed on to my kids, especially my daughter. We love to play board games, any kind of games. We just enjoy them. If it isn't fun, what's the point of doing it, right? And my dad made a putting green in his backyard. And I'm not talking like with carpet. He made a putting green with real grass, made it himself, had sand traps, it had one little tree. It was about 3/4 the size of this room. It had 9 holes on it, and eventually he made a back 9. And you would chip from different places in the yard, like your last shot onto it, and putt to hole number 1, and so forth. And it was under the lights. He had full court basketball, he had deck tennis, he had horseshoes, he had a creek running through his property. He had a dungeon with black lights and stuff in it that you could, a crawl space you could go up into. He had a pool table, he had electronic darts, he had Atari when it first came out. And my dad loved to play games. But I can remember being out there on that putting green at 1 o'clock in the morning under the lights, and we're like, tired. And we wanted to go home. It's like high school, college. And as soon as we start to leave, my dad would do this. No, 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 no. God, come on, come on, come on, come on. No, no, everybody stay. We can still do one more game. Just one more. If everybody stays, it'll be lots of fun. No, 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 come on, come on, come on. Yeah, that's it. Come on back. And he would just do this to us all the time. And I see Jesus doing that. He looks up at the tree and says, no, Zacchaeus, come on down. I'm going to go to your house and we're going to eat. We're going to have fun today. We're going to get to know each other really well. No, Martha. Martha, come on out of the kitchen. You come and join Mary and I. We're just going to sit and hang out and talk. No, Lazarus. Don't stay dead, Lazarus. Come on. Come what? Come back to life. Literally, come back to life. Come back to fun. Come back and play. One more person. He says to Peter, no, don't stop fishing. I know, you've been up all night. I know, you already got your nets cleaned and all that. But come on. Peter, let's put out to the deep. Did you go out to the deep last night, Peter? Come on, Peter. Let's go out to the deep and let's let your nets down for a catch. And what happens? What happens? His boat becomes what? Full. So full that he has to call his partners over and their boat becomes full. So much fish that the boats begin to sink. Jesus wants his house to be full. He wanted these boats to be full of fish. Why? Because they were fishers of what? Men. He wanted them to get it. It wasn't about just doing a miracle. It wasn't about just having some fish. It was showing them what the church should be like. No excuse Sunday. I did this in Urbana, Ohio, as a pastor there. I think we'll do it in the spring. But how many of you have invited somebody to church sometime and they made an excuse not to come? Anybody ever invite somebody that they made? Okay. Well, No Excuse Sunday takes care of that. No Excuse Sunday, we will put cots up for people who say it's their only day to sleep in. Okay, so they can come and they can right here, they can just lie down and sleep while the service is going on. We'll have a special section with some lounge chairs for those who feel that those chairs right there are not comfortable enough. We'll have eye drops available for those whose eyes are tired from either staying up too late on Saturday and watching TV or staying in front of a computer screen. We'll furnish blankets for those who think the church is too cold, and fans for those who say it's too hot. We'll have scorecards available for those who want to keep a list of hypocrites. Relatives and friends will be in attendance for everybody. For those who say they can't go to church and stay home and cook dinner too, we'll distribute stamp-out stewardship buttons for those who feel the church is always asking for money. One section will be devoted to some like trees and flowers for those who see God in nature. Doctors and nurses will be in attendance for those who plan to be sick on Sunday. The sanctuary will be decorated with both Christmas poinsettias and Easter lilies for those who have never seen the church without them. We'll provide hearing aids for those who can't hear the preacher and cotton for those who think he's too loud. So I actually did this in a van and gave about a 4-week notice so people invited everybody they knew to church and said, look, you can't come up with an excuse that we won't find some way to take care of it for you. And on that particular Sunday, God's house was full. Because we took away the excuses. Now that's a fun thing to do, and that's a one Sunday thing to do. And hopefully, I know if we're going to invite a friend Sunday, a similar kind of thing. There was a family who started coming to that church that had stayed in for a very, very long time. So sometimes there's a sticking power of those kind of fun things. But the idea is to get us to think about people we know and the excuses they have for not putting their faith in Jesus, for not coming to church, whatever it is. And not to do a one-time thing, but to spend time praying for them. And to pray that God would remove whatever it is that's keeping them, their possessions, their work, their relationships, whatever it is that's keeping them from God, that we'd be conscious of the fish around us that God wants us to fill up a boat with. Because Jesus is not interested in constructing a tiny church. Praise be God as we pray. Heavenly Father, I just know. Thank you that you give us one of those descriptive messages. There's really not a lot of prescription other than kind of observing our friends and family and people around us, people with whom we have some influence, and praying for them. Not just letting them go on day after day, month after month, year after year, like maybe we have. But at the very least, starting to pray for them. That whatever excuses they have, whether it was they got burned in a church at some point, or had a bad experience with a Christian, whether they just don't believe in you, whatever it is, God, that the excuses would be wiped away. They would start coming to church, and more importantly, they would come to you so that your house will be full. Today, may we commit ourselves to praying for them. In Jesus' name. And as we sing our closing song, prayer team members will be around the sanctuary. And if you just want a prayer time with somebody and say, hey, maybe I haven't prayed as well as I should for people around me. And so I want you to pray for me so that I'll be more mindful. And I'll do more of my part in seeing that God's house is full. I don't know how God will use me, but I'm going to make myself available. Or if you have any need, or a praise you'd like to share with somebody.